Good morning, good morning. Turn on the marquee lights. Good morning tonight.
Good morning, good morning. Broadway is feeling bright. Good morning tonight.
When the theaters shut their doors, we were so sad and blue.
Now we're bringing back Broadway in our Tuesday night review.
So good morning.
Good morning. We'll make you feel all right. Good morning tonight.
Tonight
for you.
Good morning.
Good morning tonight.
What a take.
Jackie Cox.
Good morning tonight, Michael.
Hello. Good morning tonight. How are you?
I'm so good. It is September 8th, which
sure
is a very exciting day if you're me, because on this day, 54 years ago, Star Trek premiered. So I am celebrating today with this Star Trek mug and a truly inside of it.
Yes. If you didn't know that Jackie Cox is a huge nerd, you do now. But Jackie, may you live long and prosper. Or
she's a nerd. She's a nerd. This is it's a communicator. And wait, it's this, Michael. What were you doing?
I think this is sign language for I love you. But
well,
sure, whatever.
I love you too. But also, yeah, live long and prosper.
Happy Star Trek Day, Jackie. I'm very happy for you.
These are the things I live for. Michael, what are you living for on this beautiful September day?
I'm living for our lineup of guests tonight because it's about to get a little autumnal in here. I don't know if you could tell, but I'm drinking from my I love pumpkin spice mug. The kids are telling me it's officially spooky season. That's what happens in September.
This is when Aiden Zane makes all of her money.
Boo! Yes,
boo!
Of course.
Michael, speaking of Drag Race, this was a big week in the kingdom, in the queendom of Drag Race. We had the Drag Race Canada finale. I know you and I were both watching that intently. Michael, what are your thoughts?
I'm thrilled. I think we crowned crowned a queen. I support all of our top three, but I thought that if you don't know, plug your ears, kids, because here come the spoilers. But also, you should know by now. I think Priyanka slayed the last day. I thought that final runway look was other level, like unbelievableness.
Gorgeous.
And she
gorgeous.
Nailed the challenge. She fully deserved it. I'm so happy for her.
She really did. She really nailed that challenge. And I loved her. Even when it wasn't her solo in that group number, she was just so on it. I was like, yes, serving me not Michelle Williams, but serving me true Kelly Rowland when she wasn't being the Beyonce, which is something we all aspire to when we're on the right or the left of whoever's singing is be the Kelly Rowland.
I'm seeing a lot of love for Aiden Zane in the comments. We have a lot of boos.
Boo.
Boo. Boo. So thanks to everybody who's joining in and getting involved. We love to see you guys in the comments, and we're glad you're all here.
It's true. It's true. In addition to Drag Race Canada, we also we're three episodes in on Drag Race Vegas.
Okay, we have to talk about this. You're obviously watching, yes?
I'm definitely watching.
I am watching. I am watching on the edge of my chair. I am loving this show. I'm obsessed with it. It's Housewives, but drag, but definitely still Housewives. I'm fully obsessed. I am so into it. What are you thinking so far?
Well, you know what's so funny is I had no idea. So they took us all to that premiere, and you see some of the girls from season 12 at the premiere in the last episode. But I had no idea they were filming a TV show. I was just like, I'm just seeing a lot of cameras. Wow, they really turned out for this. And I was like, wait, why are the cameras still at the party? What's happening? I was just like, you know, I'm going to go have another cheese doodle. But, you know, I was good. It's kind of exciting to see Drag Race expand into new categories of reality television programming. I'm sure, very exciting for the kids to see us expand into new avenues of YouTube television programming.
Here we are, coming to you live on YouTube.
Coming to you live on YouTube. And then last but not least, I believe, is it this week or next week, Drag Race Holland premieres.
Which, I don't know if you, the comments right now are blowing up for Drag Race Holland. People are very excited.
Very excited. Very excited. Yeah, and I think they're, because we have a lot, some European viewers, so they're very excited for the more cosmopolitan side of Drag Race as we leave the English-speaking world for the second time after Drag Race Thailand. And it's going to be very exciting.
Yeah, I love when the show goes into new, markets or new cultures because the first, I mean, season 12 of RuPaul's Drag Race was phenomenal. However, the early seasons of like brand new franchises are always so on fire because people are just so excited that it's finally like Drag Race Canada. This first season was like so exciting because you could tell the girls were like, finally.
Yeah, it's like finally happening.
Yeah. So I'm very excited for Drag Race Holland.
I'm excited too, and I'm also excited for everything that's happening here at the Broadway Talk Live Network for this month of September, Michael.
Yes, 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 yes. So again, many of you who watch the show, welcome back. Last month, we raised a little over $1,100 for Broadway Cares Equity Fights AIDS. You know, we love BCFA. This month, we are encouraging you to support a different cause. Our cause of the month this month is Broadway for Biden, which is an organization of Broadway people benefiting the Broadway Biden Victory Fund. Just the Biden Victory Fund. Too many words.
It's true. And if you would like to donate, rather than tipping us tonight, we're going to ask you to go directly to this URL, tinyurl.com/BWayBiden. I believe you have to be a U.S. resident. I'm not 100% sure, but I believe you have to be a U.S. resident to donate to Broadway for Biden, which if you are, please, please join us in donating. We'll be donating on our own. Unlike normal, Broadway for Biden has asked that we do not solicit tips to donate, but rather that you donate them directly. Something with the law and campaign finance reform and Elizabeth Warren. I don't know. But
we got to keep everything above the board. Look over there.
Yeah, they want to keep the big money that is, you know, a drag queen and her friend over here. They want to keep that big money out of politics. So I support them in that. But we are very excited for President Joe Biden, Vice President Kamala Harris. And it's going to take everyone to get out the vote. If you are not registered, please register to vote. We are just less than 2 months away from the election. And we need everyone in on this. Whether you're here in the United States or not, just tell everyone you know to vote. Just everyone should vote. Everyone.
Yeah.
Everyone should vote.
I love it.
And Michael, now on to the show.
Now that we've gotten all of that out of the way, you guys, we have quite a show for you tonight. Mm. We have the talented actor and singer and now the host of October State of Mind, a very spooky podcast. Ooh. Ricky Schroeder is in the house with us tonight. Oh. You guys are going to live for him, and also keep an eye on his intro because you will spot his kinky boots persona in the slideshow. Ooh. I know we have a lot of drag fans here, so keep your eyes peeled for that.
Yeah, this Ricky is no stranger to the dark arts of drag.
Yes, yes, yes. And then Broadway's very own Lady Olaf. Like, honestly, I wonder if she gets sick of hearing that. She has like 500 other Broadway credits. But yes, she was the first woman ever to play Olaf on Broadway in Frozen. And people were pretty excited about it. It's Ryann Redmond. She's with us tonight as well.
I'm very excited about it. It also makes me think, like, should Lady Olaf be a character in, like, some Game of Thrones reboot? Like, it's Olaf, but with, like, that hat.
Yes.
Lady Olaf.
I'm very, very into it.
We'll see. We'll see when the next inevitable reboot comes, because, you know, HBO just needs the money.
Well, this just coming in through my earpiece, Ryann Redmond from backstage is letting us know, no, she is not sick of hearing about Lady Olaf. So we're very excited to catch up with her. But what do you say we kick off things with guest number one, Mr. Ricky.
Let's do it, Michael.
All right. Our first guest tonight toured the country in the smash hit musical Kinky Boots.
You may also recognize him as the cute ginger that graced your television set in Hairspray Live, the last 5 years movie, The Marvelous Mrs. Maisel, and more.
Right. Most recently, he traveled to the Alliance Theater in Atlanta to be a part of the development of the Broadway-bound musical Becoming Nancy.
Yes, he was the cute ginger in that, too.
Yep, yes, of course. And now he's inviting us all to rattle our ear bones with his new spooky podcast, The Octobering.
Yes, you won't be able to see him since it's a podcast, but trust me, he's still the cute ginger behind the microphone. And since his podcast is all about celebrating his favorite holiday, regardless of what month it actually is, he's got a special performance for us tonight that celebrates that very idea. Please welcome to Good Morning Tonight, Ricky Schroeder. Talk. Hit it.
I'll be home for Christmas. You can count on me. Please have snow and mistletoe and presents under the tree. Have yourself a merry little Christmas. Make the Yuletide gay. From now on, our troubles will be miles away. They gather near to us once more. Through the years, we all will be together where the love light gleams. Oh, I'll be home for Christmas if the fates allow.
Good morning tonight. Welcome to the show, and thank you for singing for us.
Absolutely. Oh, I didn't drink.
Yeah, Ricky, what's in your mug?
Well, we've got a delicious Diet 7-Up in here.
Ooh. Merry Christmas, indeed.
Yeah.
Diet 7-Up.
Happy Halloween.
Diet 7-Up with like a sprig of cranberries, and that's a perfect holiday treat. Ricky, you're coming to us from where are you right now?
I am on Fire Island in the Pines.
Ugh, what a lovely place to be. I hear someone is doing dishes. Tell them I would like a slice. I'll be there in 4 hours or however long the ferry takes. Whatever it is that you guys are making for dinner. You know, I'm a very hungry drag queen. That's how I fit into these lovely Amazon Prime dresses. Michael, I'm very excited. I'm just blown away because
I noticed
he's the cutest ginger I've ever seen. You ask a question, Michael, while I sip on this.
Well, Ricky, hi. Thank you for joining us tonight. We're so excited to have you. I know you've spent a lot of quarantine actually out on Fire Island.
Yeah.
How has it been? How are you? How are you holding up?
Yeah, I mean, we got out here on March 14th and we thought we were gonna be here for a week. Yep. And we are still here. And you know, it's been great. It's been really good, especially when we first got out here. It was a perfect like sanctuary for us out here. After time, everything gets a little old and, you know, I start to miss the city and miss our apartment there and of course our normal lives as we all do. But there are certainly worse places to be than like in nature by the ocean. So,
right. And you're staying busy in quarantine. You are making, obviously, you are a very talented singer, which you've already shown us. You're an actor, but now you are also creating this podcast. Here it is, October State of Mind.
There it is.
Which, first of all, happy September, which is almost October.
Almost October.
I chose my mug tonight just for you.
I appreciate it.
Tell us about the podcast.
So it kind of was born out of the fact that I was just sitting here doing nothing. And like, for the first part of all this, I kind of needed to do nothing, as I think a lot of us, like, I think a lot of people were like, let's get stuff done, let's be productive. And I was in a headspace where I couldn't do that, where I just needed to be like,
right,
breathing. But then I got to a point where I've always had this idea to do like a 31 days of Halloween, like Travel Channel show where I would go and do a different Halloween activity for every day of October. But I don't know how to get in touch with the Travel Channel, so I don't know how to make it happen.
And well, are there 31 activities? My goodness.
Of course.
I thought it was pumpkin spice lattes, a trick or treat, and wear a slutty costume. Isn't that all we do? No, I'm sure
those are
more.
The main ones.
Well, if the Travel Channel is listening, Ricky's available, and here goes his handle across the bottom of the screen. It's Ricky A. Schroeder. Drop him a DM. Let's see it.
But it was just that was my original idea that I've had for years, and then. The idea to do this podcast was like, well, that's something I can actually do on my own. I don't need to rely on anyone else for it. I can just make it happen. And so I did. I made it happen. It's fun.
That's awesome.
So in each episode, are we going to deep dive into different October traditions? What is our format?
So kind of. It's partly the big chunk of it is people submitted either ghost stories or creepy true crime stories or any kind of creepy experience that they've had. And I read those aloud and add spooky underscoring and sound effects and stuff. So that's a big part of it. And then there's also, I discuss scary movies. I discuss like a lot of it has been what Halloween is going to look like this year with COVID and different things that are opening up and that aren't opening up and ways things are adapting. And I'm kind of leaving it loosey goosey. There might be one episode where I do want to talk about like the origin of the jack-o'-lantern or anything else. I've talked about like a haunted historic building in each episode with the history and the ghost stories in it. And yeah, I'm having fun with it.
Ricky, wait, have you guys heard about this? You know, because there's a lot of places do these like, normally they do like the walkthrough maze haunted houses. That's like a big tradition that I feel like it's getting bigger and bigger. But now I heard that because of COVID, some places are doing drive-through haunted houses, which, I mean, this may not surprise anyone, but if you put me behind a car and something jumps out at me, I don't trust, that's like a, that seems like a recipe for disaster. How do you feel? What are your thoughts? These are the deep, hard-hitting, hard-probing questions of Good Morning Tonight.
Actually, if you listen to episode 1 of October State of Mind, I addressed that actual concern because it was my main concern too when hearing about drive-through. It's like, how are you not going to run people over? And what they're doing with these drive-through haunts is they have like a max speed of 3 miles per hour that's monitored and you drive through the trail and then you get to a spot and everyone has to park before like any spookiness begins. Yeah. So they're not going to... rev the engine.
Here I thought they were gonna like it was gonna be like, you know, like the car wash where you just kind of kinda, like, get your car on there and you're like, I don't know what's moving my car anymore, but this is a good time as any to make out with whoever's in the passenger seat next to you as the like spooge gets all over your windshield.
Exactly.
Probably not like that. But you know, that's the things that I think about, you know, and here at Good Morning Tonight, we're not afraid of these hard-hitting questions, including this hard-hitting question, which is, when can we see you grace our screens next? How amazing was it for to be in part all these amazing movie and live musical productions, and talk to us a little bit about some of the differences you found between all of the amazing stage work you've done and then bringing that to life on film.
It's I've loved doing the TV and film stuff. It's something that I never was really anticipating or planning for, especially like Hairspray Live doing a Broadway show on live TV. Mm-hmm. First of all, when it's not a musical on TV, it's so much easier. It's so much easier than stage because, like, depending what the stuff I've done, but you just do a lot of sitting around. It's a lot of sitting and waiting, and then, you know, they set up their thing, and then you do your little thing for a minute or so, and then you wait again. And whereas when, you know, you're doing a stage show, you're like pounding the pavement, rehearsing, sweating, dancing, hurting yourself for 8 hours a day. Yeah. But then what was weird about doing Hairspray Live is we were still doing that sort of rehearsing.
Right.
And then when we actually did the show, it was to like open air, basically. You know, we didn't have an audience to get that energy from. So we would like pose to nothing, you know, and just hope that people were enjoying it.
Which is good practice for performing now on Zoom or whatever you're performing
exactly.
on.
Because you're like, exactly.
ta-da! They need to do the Jackie Cox trick where Jackie likes to edit applause for herself at the end of all of her tracks.
Yeah. Edit applause. Michael, the room just made that noise. I don't know what you were talking about. I would never add in a sweetening of applause. I earn it like any hardworking drag queen. Oh my goodness.
You do earn it.
These accusations. You see the drama
terrible.
That happens here on
terrible.
Good Morning Tonight.
Terrible.
I don't know. I can't work in conditions like
we
this.
We just fight the whole time. We don't even like each other.
And then Ricky, tell us anything on the horizon. I know it's hard because everything is shut down, but is there anything else kind of or things that you were working on that maybe you're excited to pick back up? What are some other things? What are on Ricky's quarantine goals?
Well, right before shutdown happened, I was on two episodes of Pose last season, very tiny, small role, but like I'm recurring like in the world of it. And right before quarantine, I shot another episode for season three, and then that shut down. So I don't know if I'll be back again. I have no idea once they start up production. So, but I'm hoping.
Yeah. I love that. And I think what's great about Pose too is it's so amazing. It's shot here in New York, which is amazing, you know, to actually be in the city where this culture kind of came from, and then also to use so many amazing trans actresses.
Yeah.
I think it's been so incredible to watch. And I feel like the second season was just even better than the first. And I'm hoping so much for the third season. Well, Ricky, that has me very excited because I didn't even know they'd even had done some production. So this is all good news. You heard
it
live here first.
Yeah. I know, maybe I wasn't supposed to say, but.
Well, you know what?
I did.
This is hard-hitting journalism. And sometimes things get leaked to the press.
Things come out.
When it just happens. You guys, if you're just tuning in, welcome. This is Ricky Schroeder. He has a brand new podcast called October State of Mind.
Mm.
And it is available where you get your podcasts. And it's very spooky, which leads me to this question, Ricky. This is the big question of the day.
Mm.
Do you believe in ghosts?
Of course.
You do?
But, yes, but.
Have you ever had a spooky encounter?
I do believe in spooks.
I am a very skeptical believer,
okay.
Whereas like I will find every excuse or rationale to explain something away, whereas someone could hear a bump and be like, it's a ghost. And I'm like, no, there's someone upstairs who's walking, like, you know. But I do definitely believe, and the only experience that I've ever had, you'll have to listen to episode 2 of October State of Mind.
Ooh,
find out about.
I may have listened to it today.
Ooh.
Good teaser. I love this teaser. And I do think that there is a whole new subgenre of kind of spookier podcasts or podcasts about murders. And I think that that's like becoming a whole very much big part of the podcasting world.
Because,
and is that kind of what brought you into this?
Yeah. I mean, I'm not really a huge podcast person. I don't really listen to a lot. So it was weird that I wanted to start one. Really, the only one that I listen to regularly is a podcast called Anything Ghost.
That's and, so cute. Is it about Broadway ghosts?
Anything Ghost.
It's not even about Broadway at all. It's just about ghosts. It's just stories. It's just people in their submitted ghost stories. That was definitely like, I could do something like that. But I wanted to make it a little more encompassing of ghosts, but also of autumn and fall and other creepy stories. I've only really gotten ghost stories from people so far, but I do want to like venture out into like the true crime stuff because I know that's really big. And and sometimes you just have a creepy experience with like someone at the store and it like rattles you, and that's good stuff.
I get it. For me, it was Jeff Goldblum. But anyway, Ricky, thank you so much for joining us here on Good Morning Tonight. We adore you.
Thank you, guys.
A big cheers. And I like I said, whatever anyone's cooking over there in Fire Island, I'm coming to have it because I'm just sitting here in Manhattan. But we adore you. Please come back and share more with us. And we just love you.
Love you, too.
Thanks for joining, Ricky. We'll see you
soon. Thank you, guys.
If you're just tuning in, you just missed Ricky Schroeder, you guys. His podcast, there goes his handle, first of all. Here it comes across the bottom of the screen. So if you don't follow Ricky Schroeder, It's a follow that you will appreciate. I promise you that. So go
Michael,
follow
him. And let me say this. And if they're just tuning in, that means they maybe didn't subscribe to our amazing YouTube network, which is called Broadway Talk Live, which features three amazing programs here on the YouTube, including this one called Good Morning Tonight. In addition, there is the 5:30 Quarantini on Thursdays, hosted by Michael Hull and Dylan Bustamante,
hey,
as well
me.
As MT Trivia, hosted by the Metzger Timsonses, and all of these amazing shows go to support the Broadway community, the greater theatrical community, and this month, we are supporting Broadway for Biden, Michael.
Yes, we love Broadway for Biden. We are all pulling for the Biden Victory Fund. If you are having a good time tonight and you are so inclined, you can visit, it's scrolling across the bottom, you can visit tinyurl.com/BWayBiden. I'm going to put it up here as well. And if you have the means and you would like to make a donation, we think it's a pretty good cause. We think you'd be hard-pressed to find a better place to put your money right now.
And speaking of places people have been putting money, we must say once again, thank you to everyone who helped donate last month, over the last month, this network, just through your small tips. You know, some of them were even $1, $5. All of those small tips went to Broadway Cares, Equity Fights AIDS, and we raised over $1,100 through this network.
We sure did. Did you, Jackie Cox, did you see? So yesterday was the last day of the strip-a-thon.
It was.
Which, by the way, I should have given kudos to Ricky while he was here, but both of our guests tonight were also strip-a-thoners. They were also raising money for Broadway Cares. So huge shout out to Ricky and Ryann. But did you see the totals came in of the top fundraisers of the year? And not to pat ourselves on the back, but they were two of our guests.
They were. A big, big congrats to Mark McKillop, who was the number one fundraiser, number one male fundraiser, and also Marissa Rosen, who was the number one female fundraiser for Broadway Bears this year. But you know what? Maybe Ricky and Ryann will get them next year, because we have this power, apparently.
We just do. So we're just bestowing our...
straight to the top. We'll send them there.
I loved listening to Ricky talk about the fact that, like, this podcast was born of his, like, creative quarantine energy. Because for those of you who don't know, Jackie and I were at, like, coffee or lunch, like, 2 or 3 weeks before the shutdown, talking about the fact that we should do a show together. Little did we know that this is what would happen. And here we are sitting in our own apartments with
it's
our ring lights.
Well, and I think, too, I think I even said, I was like, oh, but it'll be like in a year because I'll be so busy touring the world. And instead, I am touring the different corners of my living room. And but luckily, Michael, you and I have been able to do this show. And you, Michael, are responsible for building this amazing Broadway Talk Live network.
I'm clicking some buttons.
And so please subscribe to Broadway Talk Live network if you do not already, so you can tune into all of the amazing episodes. And also, beginning this week, I'll be putting up the musical segments from Good Morning Tonight on my YouTube page, so you can enjoy the full show, or you can just enjoy the musical numbers, whatever your choice. But I will say, the full show has all the live stuff, which, you know, if you're watching live, then you
this
get
is
to
the
be
magic.
Part of it. You see, look at this. Mm. Alice, you agree. Go Marissa and Mark. If you weren't watching live, I wouldn't have been able to talk about that amazing comment, because we support them. I think, Michael, it's time for our next guest.
I was going to say, well, we just had spooky season with Ricky, but is it getting a little chilly in here? I'm feeling a little frozen.
Ooh.
How's that for a segue?
I loved it.
Okay.
I loved it.
Well, listen, our next guest starred on Broadway in Bring It On, If Then, Escape to Margaritaville, and Frozen, where she made herstory, I'll say, as the first woman to play the role of Olaf on Broadway. She is also a self-proclaimed makeup addict, and if you follow her on Instagram, you will understand why. She brought the house down last week at Broadway for Biden's special Broadway Sessions concert, and we are just so thrilled that she's here to chat with us today. You ready, Jackie?
Welcome to the show, Ryann Redmond!
Yes!
Welcome, yes. Welcome. Yes. Cheers. Good morning tonight.
Good morning to me.
Ooh. I'm gonna guess based on that mug that is a white wine. What are we drinking?
How could you tell?
How could I? Well, it's the Star Trek.
It's Star Trek.
I'm part empath. I'm part Baby Zed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, it is a sensible Josh Chardonnay, but my favorite drink of quarantine.
I love Chardonnay, and I usually like boys named Josh, so that works really well for both of us.
Yeah, it's reasonably priced, and so I can drink about 7 bottles a day.
Happy quarantine to you. I don't actually.
Ryann, this is full. Is this a set you built? This is very high production value. Where are you coming to us from? This is beautiful.
Coming to you from Union Square. Well, I'm on 16th and 3rd. Yes. Oh, my boyfriend's apartment. Yeah,
right. And getting that evening glow, that perfect golden light. We love it. Makes the highlights really pop.
I had a down do, but as you can see, I put it up because the wind was just gusting.
At sound check earlier, she was giving you full Beyonce Super Bowl realness. But I'm glad that the hair is under control. Welcome to the show. First off, as we just mentioned, congratulations on another year of Strip-a-thon. Congratulations / thank you for all the work you're doing.
Oh my gosh. I fully went into this year just feeling so bad about asking people, this Strip-a-thon, feeling bad for asking people for money just because, you know, A lot of my donors are artists and actors and everybody involved with art. So it felt kind of icky when I started, but I was like, I need to just, if I don't try, I'm going to kick myself. And I've almost hit $3,000. So I'm just like so thrilled. I've got some amazing return donors and I'm just so glad I could contribute. But I could never be on Marissa and Mark's level. They're like, we've raised $1 million on our own. I'm like, good God, you guys.
Never say never, Ryann. I'm going to help you next year, and we're going to go straight to the top.
To the top, yes. Hey, if it's for Broadway Cares, I'll do anything. So.
Now, Ryann, prior to this shutdown, you made herstory as the first female Olaf in Frozen the Musical on Broadway. Talk to us about how did that come to be and what happened. Tell us
I got to see her in it. It was amazing.
Oh, yes,
tell us all.
Well, let's see. This came to be, I thought it was a mistake. My agent sent me an email saying I had an audition for Olaf in Frozen. Still had all of the male pronouns and the song in a male key. And I was like, Jed, I think you sent me the wrong email. This doesn't seem to be for me. And he was like, no, it wasn't a mistake. They asked for you. And I went in and that was that. I went through several rounds of Disney callbacks, which for those who don't know, it's like 95 rounds because there's so many people who have to sign off, obviously. It's such a large corporation. But I say 95, but I think it was about 5 callbacks or something like that. Just so many people have to sign off. So I had a puppet boot camp. I had never operated a puppet before. So it was a lot of, kind of just learning on the spot how to operate this tiny toddler on my feet. That's what I like to call Olaf. Then the rest was history, or herstory rather, because
herstory.
It was kind of cool. I just kind of thought I was going to be jumping into a well-oiled machine because I joined the show a year into its run. But every single person at Disney was so collaborative and helped me find my own version of this character. And because it was played by a man before, I kind of just got to jump in and create my own version of Olaf.
Yeah, and that was fantastic. Incredible. And then I would also is your performance of Olaf is Olaf still a male or is Olaf a female in your performance?
It's a great question. Olaf is still a boy. I just like to think I'm giving my voice to him, but he did not get a gender swap, although that would have been extremely progressive.
I'm all for, you know, people performing as other genders, as you can see by Michael Hall's highlights, that is something that we all approve of.
I was watching Ryann's Instagram videos today, trying to learn how to contour my cheekbones out.
Same. Anastasia Beverly Hills. That's all.
I'm gonna try wearing some makeup and see how that goes.
Good luck. Exactly. You should consider it.
It's something I've been thinking about it. And what's great? So I then did they actually change the key of like in summer for you?
Yeah, so Stephen Arimus and Brian Yusufer, who are the music supervisor and conductor, music director extraordinaires of Frozen, were super amazing about letting me kind of find what was good. And I'll never forget Brian Yusufer when we were trying to find which key we wanted to do, because there was a higher key that I could have done that would have been like, you know, extremely impressive high. I'll see, like, it's just like super high. But he was like, what will you be fine doing, like, with, when you're sick and you're tired and we're on our 10th show of the week and, you know, you can do while you're holding a puppet on your feet. And so we chose the half step lower, which, thank God.
It's like, it's like the conversation that, like, Laura Bell Bundy and Idina Menzel wish they had. It's that conversation.
I was so lucky that they allowed me to choose, but honestly, I was going to be the idiot that was like, no, I'll take the higher one, but thank goodness they led me the other direction.
Oh God, never take the higher one. Do you know how many things I moved a half step lower, sometimes a whole octave lower?
I know.
That makes it even better. And I think what's great too is, as now, you know, I'm assuming Frozen will have a very long life and be performed in high schools around the world. And now that just means that the casting, you know, it's tough, because I think casting should always be open to people of different genders, people of different ethnicities, especially when it's not integral to the character or the story. And that Olaf, there's nothing especially masculine about him, or that he needs to be played by a male presenting performer. But I do think it's so, or male identifying performer, but I think it's so exciting, because now that just means that, you know, in high schools that kids will be able to see, hey, I could play that part. You know, girls will be able to say that this is something I can do.
Absolutely.
And that's amazing to open that up. Just like it's amazing whenever we open up casting to people of different ethnicities and races, you know, to see a Black Elsa on Broadway, I think is going to be so impactful for so many kids. And I hope that that plays out, you know, because I think all of us, right, we're still theater kids. And I think for all of us who've had that experience of being like, oh, can I ever play that part? I'm so happy that you've opened another door. How amazing.
I know. It's so exciting. It's already happening too. You know, Frozen Junior is a thing. And even before Broadway shut down, every day I get a message of a girl saying, I'm auditioning for Olaf, or I booked Olaf in my school production, or they're at the stage door saying they were Olaf. And I was just like, this is why we do what we do.
And like Disney has such a way of weaving themselves into our youth and getting their songs into our hearts. And I just think it's so cool that you are such a, you will forever be such a part now of defining this Disney show, this Disney property, whatever you want to call it. I just think it's so cool that, like, you will forever be a cog in that machine that was like, oh yes. And then I changed the game. And made it available for little girls. That's just so cool.
It's real cool. And speaking no pun of, intended.
Very cool. Very cool. And speaking of cogs and machines, because in my imagination, this show must have seemed like a machine. What was it like being in If Then, which is such a show where everyone is bouncing between two storylines, and I noticed how involved the ensemble was, and you as part of it, to make everything happen in all of these different ways. What was it like doing that show? Is it as crazy as it is in my mind, or you're like, no, it's like every other show?
Jackie, it's just, you just put the glasses on and then you take the glasses
That's
off.
That's all it is.
It's a red and a blue. It's a red and a blue. Liz and Beth. No, it was honestly that was kind of an unexpected trajectory from me, because I did bring it on with Tom Kitt, who was a co-composer with Lin-Manuel, and then I got to develop If Then with Tom as well. So while I was doing Bring It On, I was starting to do the workshops, and it was just like, I'll go do a show with Idina and Anthony Rapp and LaShawn's and Jen Colella and James Snyder. And it was just like, the list kept going on, all these people that I just grew up listening to. And I couldn't have been more thrilled and honored to be a part of that process. And I just got to sit back and watch these veterans and these icons. I got to watch what their process was in the rehearsal room from start to finish. And that was such a valuable lesson to me. And then I got to do the show for a year, and it was as involved as you thought. Like, Michael Greif is such a pedestrian kind of director. So he wants all hands on deck, everyone doing everything. He didn't really like to see crew on stage per se. He liked the ensemble to feel like they were part of the moving world of the play, which was so cool, because we all had our little featured moments, and that was so cool to have in that little blip of the time. And that's when Idina was developed, or like, I think Frozen had just come out. She like rented a theater for us in DC to go watch the film. And then like that full circle moment has now been crazy. Like, wow. We went through that whole process of her like releasing the first film, and like doing the Oscars and all the Adele Dazeem stuff, like everything. It was just kind of crazy. But it really was a fantastic time. And we still are so tight knit, all of those, that entire cast.
I love that show. I saw it twice. I was like, this is like, have you ever made a choice? There's a whole musical about it.
I know, literally every day I'm like, if then, like, what if I didn't do this? And it's like, finally they put it into words and music. And you know, kind of got a little bit of a bad rap, but like, it was completely original, and it did things that other musicals had tried to do, I think, and we had a great little family, and so many people, it was so beloved by so many people, so we were just so grateful for the whole experience.
I loved it. I really did. And is there anything that's kind of coming up on the horizon, or things you were maybe working on right before quarantine that you'd love to share with us, or maybe little teasers of things maybe you're working on? We, you know, the kids want to know. The kids want to know what
I want to know too. And also, it's just like getting so dark. I'm sorry if you can't see me.
No, you're good.
I'm leaning closer to my computer. I mean, I was developing Muriel's Wedding, the fantastic Australian film starring Toni Collette. They've made a musical of it, and they did an Australian production, several productions in Australia actually, but they have been trying to bring it to the U.S. So before quarantine, did a workshop. So hopefully, we've got some more of those workshops on the horizon, because it's such a role of a lifetime. It's a role that I never thought I would get to play. I'm usually the sidekick or the comedic relief, which I love. I absolutely love. Muriel is just such a character with, she's funny, but she's also there's a sadness, and it's just like every single thing that an actor would want to do in a musical, Muriel does. And just like the music is so freaking fantastic, because it has some ABBA in there.
Oh, it does. I was actually, I was wondering, because the movie is so informed by the ABBA music, and I was like, is that going to be part of the show? Because that's so exciting.
Yeah, and they had to obviously set it apart from Mamma Mia, but in Muriel's Wedding, ABBA is kind of like, they're like summoned, they're Muriel's in her brain when she's feeling sad or when she's feeling nervous. She summons ABBA, and they're kind of like her Greek chorus.
Greek chorus!
Yes.
Nerds.
Yeah, Lele Blonde, love it. But they found this husband and wife writing duo in Australia who are iconic, and they've written some, because they needed to find music that was going to match ABBA's obviously amazing tone, and then also not overshadow it, but also be as good as it, that's right. Too much Chardonnay. But
never enough. Good morning.
Good morning. Good night. This Kate Miller Heidke, she's like the Australian Sarah Bareilles / like Regina Spektor. She's so cool, and she's a recording artist there, and she's got the coolest music, and she infused that into Muriel's Wedding, and it's so good. Yeah.
That is incredible. Ryann, thank you so much for joining us. Thanks to all of our guests for joining us. Ricky, I'm bringing you back in. This has been such a lovely time with both of you. I think, you know, it's so amazing to see both of your faces. And I also just to know that, you know, that this community still can exist in this time, and we can still find ways to be together, to work on things. Big congrats, Ricky, on your podcast, everything. Ricky, you're muted, but I'll unmute you from here. Oh, I can't. You muted yourself, but that's okay.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. You're welcome. And, you know, I because in my past life, I think I was, I don't know, some kind of misguided guidance counselor. I'd love to ask both of you a parting question, which is what right now is making you both hopeful? I'll go first in that I think what's making me so hopeful is in addition to seeing everyone kind of still, you know, finding ways to live and work and breathe and exist in this new world. I think what's so exciting too is seeing how everyone is, almost everyone I know has taken some time to reflect on how to be better people. You know, and I think that definitely comes true through the Black Lives Matter movement. And I think also as a Broadway community, the amazing, amazing outpouring of donations that happened over the last month for Broadway Cares. I was honestly surprised at how much money that all of you were able to raise. And so big thank you to both of you for being part of that. And that's bringing me some hope. Ricky, what's bringing you some hope?
What's bringing me some hope is seeing the innovation that is coming out of this time in all aspects of, you know, people's lives and industries, between like you guys doing a Zoom podcast or StreamYard, I guess. and even like just in doing my podcast and doing the research about stuff that's going to go on for Halloween and the drive-through haunts and stuff. And even the grocery store out here in the Pines, what they've done all summer is they aren't letting people inside. You just email them your orders and you go and pick them up. And so that keeps everyone safe and healthy. And it's just, you know, the world doesn't stop turning. And if we weren't able to adapt and change and innovate, you know, we would be stuck. But people are so creative that we can continue turning along with the world, which gives me hope.
I love that. Ryann?
I love that too. Same, just seeing all of my friends like create artwork and artwork, anything in this time that feels like we're so stifled is so inspiring. And same with me as well about people finding it in their hearts to donate and stand up against causes that they feel are right, and being on the right side of history, like even when we're going through one of the darkest times of our generation and of our of my generation, but of a lot of people's lifetimes, and just finding ways to find the light in that is so inspiring to me. And whether that be through Broadway Cares or whether it be through the Black Lives Matter movement, and whether it be through people deciding they want to run for office to change what they've been preaching this for so long, like just people just getting lighting a fire under their booties and being like, okay, well, now's the time. I'm literally doing nothing else. Yeah. So now's the time to do what I've been wanting to do for so long.
I love that. Yeah. I love that. Cheers, my darlings. Good morning tonight.
Cheers. It
Thank
is
you
night
so
here.
Much. For joining us on this this September's episode as we celebrate the fall season.
Yes,
I can't wait to listen to your podcast, Ricky.
Yeah,
it's going to be great, and I hope the two of you work together in the future so that Michael and I can sit in the front row with popcorn and say we knew them.
I hope so too.
Oh, my goodness. Well, you guys, thank you, thank you, thank you for coming. To our viewers, one last time, if you are watching and you had fun tonight and you were so inclined, please consider making a donation to Broadway for Biden. They are donating to the Biden Victory Fund, which we think is a pretty good cause. So please donate to them. Jackie and I's parting. Ooh, I should tell you, Jackie alluded to this earlier, but there are three other shows coming up in the next week. This Thursday is the 5:30 Quarantini with me again and my buddy Dylan Bustamante. Our guests, it's a three for you guys. Get excited. We are hanging out with Christine Dwyer, Matt DeAngelis, and George Salazar. It's going to be a whole party. That is on Thursday at 5:30. And then, of course, on Monday, you've got MT Trivia. Three rounds, two Broadway guests, only one winner. Who will it be? Your guests are Joe Carroll and Dan Tracy. And then Jackie, I'll see you again on Tuesday for another episode of Good Morning Tonight. Do we tell them who we just booked, or do we leave it a secret and announce it on social?
I think we'll announce it on social, which means you have to follow us at B-Way Talk Live.
Ryann, I'll tell you as soon as we get off the air. But for everybody else, follow us. We're very excited about next week's guest. And we hope you'll all come back and hang out with us. Our closing words tonight are inspired by our guests, our very inspiring guests. Ricky, thank you for bringing us into spooky season.
The fall.
And for your new spooky podcast. And Ryann, Lady Olaf, Lady of the Broadway, we love you. Jackie, you ready to close this out?
I am, and I hope we did it okay in the original key.
I hope we did too. good morning tonight. We love you all, and we'll see you next week.
Good morning.
Trees will sway. I'll get a pumpkin spice latte. We'll be playing whatever kids play in autumn.
A hat on my head, an infinity scarf of finest thread, the leaves all turning orange and red in autumn.
I'll finally see a pumpkin patch or an apple picking farm, and find out what happens to boys in Speedos when it's not warm.
And I can't wait to see what my buddies all think of me. Just imagine how much cooler I'll be in autumn.
Da da, doo doo, ba 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 ba. Boo! This summer was weird and for a good reason, but bring on the autumn. Let's have spooky season.
Winter's a great time to stay in and stitch, but put me in autumn and I'll be a basic drag queen.
When autumn comes, or as some like to say, the fall, I love to drink warm cider with some alcohol.
Oh, we all will vote blue.
We hope quarantine will be through
when we finally do what basic queens do in autumn.
Wait, doesn't autumn start on the 21st?
Not according to Starbucks.